Good afternoon. Thanks everyone for tuning into our webinar on circular clothing with our guest speaker, Shani Wood. My name is Kat Heinrich. I'm an associate consultant at Rawtec. For those of you who don't know us, Rawtec is an Australian waste management consultancy. We work across the country helping local councils, state governments and businesses with a range of waste and resource management issues. This is the third in a series that we are running on a webinar series to share best practice and innovation in the Australian waste and resource management sector. Each fortnight, we're inviting leaders and innovative thinkers to share their projects and insights. So today, we're talking about circular clothing. Textile waste is a topic that hasn't received much attention compared to, say, single-use plastics. But we know that Australia's textile consumption has a huge environmental impact, not to mention all the social and health issues associated with people making our clothes overseas in often poor working conditions. So in a few minutes, we'll be hearing from Shani Wood, who recently undertook a global study tour looking into textile waste, and we'll hear about what we can do about this issue. Shani will share her research findings on what happens to clothing that is donated in Australia, as well as initiatives from across the globe to reduce textile waste. She will also share her insights on what opportunities we have in Australia to become a leader in circular textiles management. But before we hear from Shani, I would like to cover off on some housekeeping. So a few things to cover. This webinar will run for about 50 minutes. It is an interactive webinar, so do encourage you to post your questions. There's a Q&A box somewhere at the bottom of your screen, so please feel free to put your questions in there as they pop up. And you don't have to wait to the very end to put your questions. We will take some throughout, but we will probably hold a lot to the end. And also, lastly, we are recording this webinar, so if you don't get the chance to catch it all today, or if you would like to recap, we will be sending around the recording after. So, without further ado, I'd like to introduce our guest speaker, Shani Wood, who is an environmental officer for the City of Holdfast Bay. We at Rawtec have been lucky enough to work with Shani on a range of projects over the years. And if Shani had a hashtag, it would be hashtag make it happen. because she passionately drives projects forward, and we've seen that over the years with Shani. So one example is Shani's work on Australia's first compostable bag supermarket trial. This project has, I think, in my opinion, is a bit of a game changer, and it's received a lot of national attention from local governments and media across Australia. And it received the SA LGA Award for Excellence in Environmental Leadership and Sustainability. Shani's leadership has been recognised by Green Industries SA, and in 2019 she was awarded the GISA Women and Waste Leadership Award, which gave her a scholarship to investigate textiles waste, which we'll hear about today. So, a warm welcome to you, Shani.
Oh, thank you for the kind words, Kat. It's always a pleasure working with you guys at Rawtec.
So, to get started, just how much textile waste do we generate in Australia?
A lot. So Australians are the second highest consumers of textiles, with the average Australian purchasing 27 kilos of textiles per year. Of this 27 kilos, only 15% are being reused or recycled. So in the City of Holdfast Bay, we're a small coastal council in Adelaide, and we've got a medium to high social economic demographic. We are finding a per week, which is being sent directly to landfill. So this is not only significant loss of resources, but it also has an economic impact for councils, meaning that we have to spend over $40,000 a year and growing to dispose of these textiles.
So massive local impacts, financial cost implication you mentioned, and it's not a good outcome that at the moment 85% of textiles
are in
landfills across Australia. That's quite a staggering statistic there. But how about on the global level?
Globally, it's even scarier. So since the year 2000, global production of clothing has doubled. And it's really hard to find accurate data on the impact, because as you can imagine, there's so many micro factories across the world producing textiles in really poor social conditions that we just can't access information. But what we do know is the textile industry is the second dirtiest in the world behind oil, and is responsible for 10% of global carbon emissions and 20% of global wastewater.
Wow, so 10% of greenhouse gas emissions. So really, it's a a massive opportunity from greenhouse gas emissions. So we're not just talking about diverting materials from landfill, we're talking about greenhouse gas emissions as well. So given that this is such a big and massive complex issue, because you know the textiles are being made overseas, well, a lot of them are being made overseas and we're importing them, and this it's compounded the issues of fast fashion, etc. Where do you even start? You know, where did your, you did some research on textile waste, where did you focus your research?
So my research had three aims, the first being to get an understanding of what proportion of Australian textiles which are being donated to charity are being reused and what programs we can implement here to ensure they don't end up in landfill. The second being research and engagement programs that motivate individuals to change their textile shopping behaviour and dispose of unwanted or used textiles responsibly. And the third, which was the most exciting for me, was researching the opportunities for textile reuse and recycling. I feel it's really important to point out at this point that whilst my project didn't have a social focus, there is a lot of impact socially from textile manufacturing. So 1 out of 6 people in the workforce globally work in garment manufacturing, 80% of which are female, only 2% are paid a livable wage. So I'd like to point that out. It's not in the scope of my work, but it's an important issue when we talk about textiles as well.
Yeah, it is. And I think, yeah, you've raised a really good point there, Shani, because, you know, when we start to have a chat about what we can do about it, I think we need to keep in mind that it is, we're in a global economy. Mm-hmm. Decisions that we make locally in the policy context do have the flow-on effects. So that should always be considered as well. So you've got these three massive research questions, which is still quite a large scope to cover. So how did you go about finding the answers to these questions?
Yeah. So with my grant from Green Industries and the City of Holdfast Bay, I was lucky enough to travel interstate to Sydney, Coffs Harbour, and overseas to Brussels and London to speak to experts in their field about how they are playing their part in reducing clothing going to landfill. So I spoke to clothing charities and collectors locally and in England, researchers at a textile conference in Brussels, innovators, local governments, policy implementers, and organisations who are all playing their part in this field. There has been radical technical advancements and innovative programs implemented in the past 18 months. And I often felt like the more I knew, the less I did, because there is so much going on, but it's a really exciting time for us and lots of opportunities that we can get involved in here in South Australia.
Yeah, no, that's great. And absolutely. Sometimes yeah. More research topic than you realize you don't know, but yeah, I'm sure you've learned a lot through that process. And so on that point, you know, what did you find out about how textiles are currently managed in Australia? Because at the moment, you know, being an Australian, I have my textile waste. I might drop them off at a charity if I can, but I don't really, I guess the average Australian doesn't really know what happens beyond that point.
I was really lucky to speak to representatives from the Binnie's and Salvo's stores. So both charities rely really heavily on your donations of good quality clothing, because they fund up to 90% of the amazing social programs they run, such as providing meals for the homeless and shelter for the vulnerable. So both stores, and it's the same across interstate and in London, have experienced an overall increase in clothing donations, but a decrease in the quality of garments that can be sold in store, and that's due to fast fashion. Salvo sell clothing unfit for sale to an industrial rag company for a considerably lower profit, as well as export some items overseas, which also provides us lower revenue. Binnie's have a similar model, but export all clothing that can't be sold in store overseas.
Okay, so it gets sold, they try to sell it here first.
Yeah, what they can, yeah.
If they can't sell it, then they make sure it goes to, you know, so it's not just going straight to landfill, it's actually...
Correct.
Exported overseas, to maybe turned into rags or sold in another secondhand market overseas. Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
And I don't know if you got the chance to explore this in your research, Shani, but I wonder if we're kind of passing on the problem of the textiles. Mm-hmm. If they can't be sold in overseas markets, do they come back to Australia?
Exporting our textiles is such a grey area, and there's always going to be people globally and interstate that can't afford clothes. So there's always going to be a need for clothing donations to be exported to help the community. But we can also, on the other side, places like East Africa, they're banning the imports of textiles and affecting their textiles economy. So as long as we're smart about it, and we've got companies like SDR that work with charities such as Red Cross and Save the Children, and they take what they can't sell in store, and they only send them overseas where they know there's a need. So they're not sending an Audi special buy ski jacket to Africa, they're sending it to somewhere like Madagascar where it's needed.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah. And we touched on before the fast fashion issue, and you mentioned just how many clothes that people throw out every year. If I remember the stat correctly, you said 27 kilograms per household per week, per year, sorry.
Yep.
So that's a lot of clothing, because clothes don't necessarily weigh that much. I think, you know, gosh, if you add that to the number of t-shirts, it would be quite a number of t-shirts that people are buying every
Absolutely.
Year.
Absolutely, yeah.
Given this... you know, how do you actually stop that flow of textiles being bored and then chucked out in the bin? Were there any programs or initiatives that you came across in your research that you would regard as best practice in that engagement space?
Yeah. So first, I think most people in this Zoom meeting would understand the waste hierarchy. Obviously, it's a lot better for the environment if we avoid, reduce and reuse our textiles before sending it to landfill. But I think I've just got a slide which Kat's going to put up now. We've all seen the waste hierarchy before, but I thought another good example is Maslow's hierarchy of needs, the 2020 edition. I thought, one, we could share that because it's funny, but two, because many of us seem to have this strong need and desire to buy new clothing, but we don't actually need new clothing. We should be encouraging our community that, yes, if you want new clothes, you can have them, but make sure that you buy secondhand where possible and you buy durable garments where possible as well.
I've just popped this slide up for you, Shani. So your Maslow's hierarchy, human needs in 2020. So the most fundamental need is toilet paper.
Then fast fashion.
People in the shops, which thank God there's more toilet paper on the shelves just recently. But yes, that's interesting as you are.
Yeah.
Moving up the hierarchy physiologically. Safety needs being met, love and belonging, esteem. And actually, yeah. Think about the clothing across this hierarchy, because you can even think about, you know, in the safety and, you know, just keep staying warm and staying safe and then, you know, associating yourself with a sense of belonging with what you wear through to self-esteem. So it's interesting.
Yeah, your status. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
About that, the clothing play a role, but how can we, as you said, how can we reduce it?
So there's a lot of really good examples, especially with one clothing charity that I met with in England called Trade UK. Trade are a clothing collection charity who work closely with local governments and run a number of engagement programs with communities and schools. So they run repair cafes. I think we've got a picture up there, which I think is absolutely amazing. And there's a guy there fixing up his backpack. That's absolute goals. I love that. So they're encouraging our community to be reskilled on skills that we've lost through generations on fixing the clothes instead of throwing them away. So Trade also run various pledge campaigns where individuals can pledge to purchase a certain proportion of clothing secondhand. Pledges are rewarded with access to exclusive events and first look at clothing for free sale. They also have a 23% campaign cap, which encourages Londoners to donate the 23% of clothing which we have in our wardrobes that we don't actually wear.
23% of clothing in the average person's wardrobe is just left over.
So almost one out of four garments we're not wearing, and it's just sitting in our wardrobe, waiting to be worn or donated to someone who will wear it.
Yeah. Well, that's a
good issue. Yeah. So there's also a new pledge movement here in Australia with Salvos and Vinnies called Moving the Needle, and it involves working with charities and retailers to that pledge that they will encourage customers to donate their clothing once they no longer need them. The Salvos are also working close with the Iconic, which are an online retailer who provide prepaid satchels that can be used to donate clothing through Australia Post. Both campaigns are quite new, but have shown initial really exciting results. So lastly, I'll just touch on an Australian fashion brand called Citizen Wolf that I was lucky enough to meet with in Sydney. They have a zero waste model. So they sell made to measure clothing through laser cut using a measurement and weight algorithm that works with 94% of the population. they recently ran a Black Friday campaign. So Black Friday is normally when people go out and buy a lot of stuff they don't need, but they're actually encouraging people on Black Friday to turn in clothes that are a little bit warm to be re-dyed into black to give them a second life. So this campaign saved approximately 60,000 litres of water compared to if all items were sent in bought brand new.
All right, and when did you say that Citizen Wolf campaign was held? Is that Australian or?
So yeah, that's an Australian clothing retailer, and Black Friday is traditionally in November of each year. So that was November last year.
It'll be interesting to see that program rolled out in the US. The footage of the people banging down the shop walls.
Yeah.
By
crazy
prices. So yeah, interesting. And you know, while talking about this as well, you know, really about, as you've touched on, it's reducing clothing waste from being generated in the first place. And I'm really curious to understand how the choice of materials impacts the ability to keep clothing circulating in the economy. How does the choice of material impact whether it's, you know, recyclable or easier to repair, etc.?
Sure. So most garments are made of leaded materials like polyester and cotton, which makes the fabric more durable, but it's actually harder to recycle because it's two types of materials. So using natural fibres allows to recycle the material easier. For example, in Europe, there's a cradle-to-cradle program where workwear made from natural-derived fibres is composted, and the produced compost is then used to make more fibres to make more workwear, so true circular economy. So the issue there is the zippers and buttons, but there's been a lot of advances in technology which can remove these items quite easily. So just wanted to touch on plastic, because it's a real interesting one. Plastic is cheap and has its place. It makes clothing durable. Mm-hmm. But research shows us that washing synthetic textiles is responsible for 35% of primary microplastics released into the ocean, which is really scary. So we need to think about how we can capture these plastics through the use of special wash bags and filters, and maybe even have a movement back to natural fibres. And in saying a movement back to natural fibres, maybe not just think about cotton, but think about fibres like hemp.
Mm-hmm.
There's been a movement in China back to hemp. So hemp uses up to four times less water resources than cotton and doesn't need pesticides.
Okay. So you're saying, you know, move to hemp, move to natural materials, and mm-hmm. by doing that, it reduces the amount of resources used in production.
Absolutely, and there's an opportunity for Australia here. I guess we could ask the question, we're such a dry continent, why are we growing cotton here when there's real opportunity for hemp, which is a lot more adaptive to our climate and uses a lot less water?
So moving on from that, did you see any programs, interventions that were effective in reducing the amount of textiles that ends up in landfill?
So I've got lots of examples on this one for you, Kat. So starting out with a focus group, which was undertaken by a Belgian company called Recentex across five European countries, they found that in general, millennials and Gen Ys are only willing to travel up to 7 minutes to dispose of their unwanted clothing. So this data backs why a clothing collection model trial by three in northern New South Wales near Coffs Harbour was so successful. So households were given a thick bag to fill with clothing that was then placed in their curbside recycling bin. So once that bag reached the recycling facility, it was pulled out and distributed amongst all charities in the area. So this pilot had an incredibly high participation rate, which demonstrates that people really want to do the right thing with their clothing, and as long as we can make it as convenient as possible. But unfortunately, there are issues with too many clothes being donated that the region's charities could handle. So again, we're talking about that oversupply in the market. So it shows, yes, we should be encouraging people to donate their clothes, but also need to encourage people to reuse them where possible and buy durable as well. So next thing I wanted to talk about was legislation, and I know legislation isn't very sexy, but it's a really powerful tool, especially in France, where since 2009 they've had an extended producer responsibility law which mandates clothing, home textiles and footwear, so CHF, manufacturers and retailers are responsible for providing recycling and reuse options for the end use of their products. So in 2018, 100% of these French retailers and manufacturers, which is about 4,000 businesses, passed their responsibility onto the accredited authority, which is EcoPLC, who implemented these programs on their behalf. So the way it works is you pay a tax per garment, which is dependent on the size of the garment and if it has an eco weighting. So an eco weighting is whether or not the garment has recycled content in it or if it can pass a durability test. So so it's really exciting. So putting the responsibility on the retailers and the manufacturers. So French residents can dispose of their clothing through many methods that we have here, but there's just a lot more of them. So there's more in-store donation points, charity drop-offs, door-to-door collections, and on-street hubs which are open 24/7.
It kind of reminds me of the e-waste product stewardship scheme that we have in Australia.
Very similar, yeah. So with the money made from the scheme, which they've made about €4 million since 2009, it's fed back into R&D products that fund new innovations like vertical gardens, which are made from textiles, machinery that can remove zippers and buttons, like we spoke about earlier, and housing insulation.
Okay. So I guess the product stewardship scheme is an interesting one, and it's an approach we've taken in Australia for e-waste and a few other problematic items.
Yeah.
Did you just touch on again on the results from the product stewardship scheme in France? What was the impact?
Sure. So if you remember at the start, we said that only 15% of our 27 kilos that we buy is being reused, recycled. But in 2018, 38% of the tonnage equivalent of clothing that entered the market was captured through the scheme, which is really exciting. And of that 62% left, you can imagine that a lot of that would still be in people's wardrobes. So it's working really well and encouraging people to do the right thing to donate their clothing.
So it's definitely having an impact in
France. Yeah. Yeah, and then it continues to fund more innovation and R&D, which is really exciting.
Well, I would actually like to launch a question to the audience. I'm going to put a poll forward. I'm going to ask a question. So do you think Australia should consider introducing a mandated product stewardship scheme for textiles? So I've just launched the poll. You should see four options to answer. Yes, definitely, only if it's a voluntary scheme. No, it shouldn't be the responsibility of clothing manufacturers, importers, and no for another reason. So I'll leave that open for a short while. We've got 36 votes so far. We're creeping up to 44 votes so far. I'll give you another 10 seconds. I can see the clear winner, which perhaps is not such a surprise given the people who were
talked it up.
In this space. All right, I'm going to end the polling now and I'm going to share the results with everybody. So interestingly, from the people we have joining us today from a range of different backgrounds, so I should say on the audience, hi everyone who's joining us, we have policy makers online, we have people working in the reuse and repair of clothing as well, we have educators, we have business owners, etc. And this audience is saying yes, definitely. 94% of people who voted in this poll think that Australia should consider introducing a mandated product stewardship scheme for textiles. So an interesting one to follow up on, Shani. I don't know if you had any discussions about this opportunity throughout your research with any policymakers in Australia.
No, but it is mentioned in my research project, which is with the state government now. So,
yeah, okay. Yeah, all right. Well, maybe, yeah, that might be one going forward.
Yeah.
An opportunity for Australia, perhaps. And like you said before, it's getting that funding to be able to fund some of these initiatives which you've talked about, which
absolutely
are successful in improving the convenience, making it easier for people to drop off their items and some of the other initiatives.
Yeah.
I would like to touch on recycling of textiles because it's an area that people are very familiar with reuse and even ripping it up into rags, etc. But how do you actually recycle textiles? Have you what kind of examples do you
have? So I've got two really exciting examples because there's always going to be textiles that people aren't going to want to reuse, like old hospital bed sheets and those really damaged clothing as well that we can't reuse them. They're probably not good for rags, but let's recycle them and recover the materials in them and turn them into something new. So for me, this was probably the most exciting part of my project, hearing about world-leading recycling innovation happening right here in Australia CAP, which provides us with some really exciting opportunities for both job growth, which is really important as we come out of the COVID outbreak, and in South Australia as we want to move towards that all-important circular economy. So Blocktex, they're an innovation company that developed technology that can recover polyester and cellulose from poly-cotton blended textiles that can then be used for a multitude of products, including textiles, paint, cosmetics, pharmaceuticals, furniture, and even back into road surfaces. So what's even more exciting about the Blocktex model is we can look at blockchain technology, where you can supply those that have provided the textiles with a report validating that the textiles have been processed, the kilogram output of the polyester and the cellulose, and details as to who purchased the recovered material. So a really good example of this, like I touched on before, would be hospital bed sheets. So SA Health could give 10 tons of bed sheets to Blocktex. They could recover the cellulose and the polyester, and then they could take that same cellulose and polyester and turn it back into new bed sheets. So it's a complete circular loop.
Wow. And what kind of size plant would you need to have that kind of technology?
Yep.
In South Australia.
So Blocktex, they trialled a 10,000 tonne a year plant in Mackay. A 10,000 tonne a year plant in South Australia would create 30 direct and 30 indirect jobs, as well as inject $47 million into a regional economy.
Sounds like a great opportunity for the stimulus packages.
Oh, absolutely.
COVID.
South Australia open for business, I think. Let's do it. So another exciting use for textiles is found at the University of New South Wales, where glass, which is also quite a troublesome recycled material, and textiles are combined together to make unique high-end furnishing panels, such as tiles and tabletops. So have we got that slide up there, yeah, Kat? Yep.
Slide up for everyone to see, because you did have a picture of
yeah.
People visualise what you're talking about. So can you see that slide?
Yep. So on the left there, that's the polyester fibres and the cellulose which come out of the reactor from the Blocktex model, which can then be used to create more materials. And on the right there, that's some tiles that have been created from the combination of glass and textiles. So the colour of the textile used dictates the end colour of the furnishings, and various blended fabrics can be used in this model, with the University of New South Wales also looking to sell this technology to create these furnishings in microfactories across Australia, which again creates jobs and growth and helps us reach our circular economy targets.
Yeah, wow. Those tiles, I can imagine them selling quite well there.
Yeah, they've got quite a high-end look, don't they?
They do.
Yeah. Good talking point as well when you have a dinner party, I think.
My old dress. So there's a huge opportunity here for South Australia, and Australia is what I'm hearing in terms of
in
some of these technologies.
Absolutely.
Our product stewardship scheme to fund some of the collection points and the processing side of things. So what is holding us back from actually implementing these initiatives? What are the barriers that we're facing?
So do we want the barriers stopping, I think, Australians from reducing textile waste? So we'll talk about the consumer. I think it's all about convenience, like we know. So we need to make donating textiles as easy as possible, and we'll find more people putting in the extra effort to ensure clothes have a second life. So if we embrace and promote easy methods like booked home collections, donating through Australia Post, which we talked about with the Iconic, and promoting drop-off points, maybe like a search engine, it's making the committee more aware of where they can drop off their textiles. This will really help us increase our landfill diversion rate. We also, like I mentioned earlier, it's a lost skill repairing your clothes. I've only recently started repairing my clothes, so I think there's opportunity there. We do have repair cafes here in Adelaide, but maybe we can expand them, have them across councils and in different regions in South Australia.
Yeah, that's a good point. Those skills certainly can be lost, and it was unthinkable to say my grandma that you would throw something away as soon as it rips.
Absolutely,
fast fashion. I've heard stories of teenagers buying clothing to wear once and throwing them away, not because they're even damaged, but because they don't want to be seen wearing it price. So
yeah, I think so. I think we need to install in the community, realizing that there is value in our textiles. They do have resources and that we can recover. And yet they're worth money. So we need to do the right thing here.
Yeah, that's it, because there seems to be a big disconnect. It's similar to the food waste issue that people don't they're removed, they live in cities, etc. So they don't have that appreciation of all the energy, effort and resources that go into the production.
Maybe
all kids should be sent to Bangladesh to get a appreciation.
Yeah.
How it works and all the challenges associated with it.
Definitely.
So I've got a question here from Chelsea McLean, just talking about kids and the education companies. She asks, are there any tips for how you would explain to kids and talk to them about how they can be part of the solution?
I came across a few programs. So Trade UK, they do workshops with schools, and so does SCR, which is an Australian organisation. So there are workshops out there which you can talk to kids about. There's value in your clothes, please don't throw them in the bin, and please wear them more than once. Off the top of my head, I think it's all about tailoring the language to stuff that the kids can understand, but probably speaking to those experts is the first point of call. And maybe looking on the Trade website and see what they've got to offer the kids as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And we've got some comments on the chat channel saying, next webinar topic, how to sew up your socks. Kids are easy, adults are hard. So, and the art of mending. So there's a essay, has Adelaide Unley and Payneham teaches kids to sew and mend. So there's a lot of initiatives, and you've touched on this already. Supporting those initiatives.
Absolutely. So we definitely need a holistic approach here. There's not one solution that will fix it all for us. And I think from a local government perspective, I think our role definitely fits with an engagement. So we're the tier of government that's closest to community. So we could be working with those organisations in running repair cafes and workshops, pledge programs, similar to what we do, encouraging people to put their food in the green bin and letting our community know where those drop-off points are. I think there's also a role for us as councils in procurement. So last year, a number of South Australian councils signed an MOU to purchase materials made of recycled content, which we commonly find in our curbside recycling bin. This could be expanded to include materials that can be recycled, but just not through curbside service, such as textiles. So let's take it one step further and include textiles now that we've got options to buy them back, like in tiles and furnishings.
Yeah, okay. So there's like you said, steps that need to happen. It kind of makes me think there needs to be a really coordinated approach on this issue, maybe a textiles strategy for the state or country. All these amazing people around Australia doing all these great things. There's all these opportunities with the technology. There's a need for investment. There's potentially a need for a product stewardship scheme, etc.
Yeah.
It's the interesting idea to maybe pull it all together and have a bit of an effort on this.
Yeah.
So what do you see the role of local governments in this picture?
Yeah. So that's where I think we can have the procurement role and engagement programmed as well. And I think there is potentially a role for councils to be involved in drop-off point programs. So it's really interesting. In England, charities actually have to pay councils to have their clothing hubs on their land. So we don't really have a system here. They just pop up and we're happy to have them there because they're saving us money. People are putting their clothes in these hubs and not ending up in landfill. So there is an opportunity for us to investigate whether or not we could be involved in maybe an at-home collection model.
That's a good one. So via the do you see that being via the curbside model, like the COFs, or the bag model?
Maybe separate from the cough, so it's on call, so it's when you need it, so you'd have a higher participation rate. And there's also issues with coughs that the recycling bin wasn't big enough to fit the bags in it, and the bags split once they reached the MRF. So I think definitely more of an on call when need model.
Yeah, That's a big opportunity for councils, absolutely. Yep. And how about how about state government? How do you see them fitting into this picture?
As we touched on earlier, there's so much data and knowledge gaps here in Australia that if we knew the answers to, it would help us develop more effective campaigns. So perhaps if the state government could run a focus group similar to what we saw overseas in Brussels and five other countries, we would have an understanding of what our community is thinking and have more effective programs in place to help increase resource recovery rates. Mm-hmm. So again, really exciting, that new technology we spoke about. We as South Australians, we pride ourselves on 40 years of CDL, 10 years of single-use plastic bag ban. So let's continue to be leaders in this space, provide jobs. With our second highest unemployment rate in Australia, it's a real opportunity for us to inject jobs, come out of COVID and head towards circular economy.
Yeah, well, that's right. And I think I was watching a segment from Waleed the other day talking about as terrible as COVID is, what's the opportunity at the end of this? How can, our economy is reduced significantly recently in isolation measures, but we're going to eventually come out on the other side.
Absolutely. There's a lot of stimulus packages there at the federal and the state levels. So we can look at how can we use that funding to embrace the circular economy.
Exactly. And it really is a big opportunity to think about how can we rethink our economy and what innovations we can do? How can we use this opportunity, even though it's pretty challenging times right now, but how can we use this opportunity to accelerate circular economy initiatives and reduce waste, save people money, as you said, create more jobs for South Australians and Australians? There is a really big opportunity.
Yeah, absolutely. Finding resources and things we used to waste, like textiles. So many exciting opportunities, yeah.
And when it comes to businesses, so we know the H&M example where you can drop off any textiles you like for free. If I understand correctly, they give you a voucher to buy more.
They do. It's a grey area, the H&M model. I think it's fantastic. They're the world's second biggest clothing retailer, and they've definitely signaled to the market that they want to be sustainable with end use of clothing. But they're rewarding people that are coming in to drop off their textiles with a voucher to buy more fast fashion, which in essence is a little bit of the problem. But what really is exciting is about the H&M model is they sell that onto a third party. And I think for every tonne they sell onto the third party, 2 euro cents gets donated to UNICEF. And you can find out on the H&M website how many tonnes each country has donated. And about 40% is sold for rewear or reuse, and 40% is actually recycled in a factory in Hong Kong. And only a very small proportion is used for alternative energy. So none of that's going to waste. And fantastic that H&M want to do the right thing, but maybe look at a different incentive scheme to get people in to donate their clothes.
I've got another question here from Aubrey Thomas. Do you have any insight into what Manrags does? I haven't personally heard of Manrags. The clothing they collect, I've read they accept 10 kilogram boxes that are collected from homes for $25 and repurpose or recycle the clothes and shoes.
Yeah. I don't know too much about Manrags, Audrey, but I did reach out to them and I mentioned them a little bit in my report. So it's a very new campaign where you can send in your old socks and, yeah, like you said, old clothing, and they recycle it into new items. So that, again, that's that knowledge gap. Things are happening so quickly that we could all work together and provide a holistic approach to this problem.
Yeah, and there's another question here from Emily Newton with regards to not fit for resale textile waste. Do you have any comments about private Australian companies that promote both the collection of good resale clothing and old clothes for recycling?
So
is there a risk that they sell most donation for textile scrap? Is where their mission is asking.
I guess at the end of the day, there's such an oversupply of clothing, so it's better that they are getting turned into scrap or being sent overseas as long as there is a need than going into landfill. So I think there's a lot of room in the sector for everyone to play their part.
Yeah, like you say, in that generation of textile waste up front. And another question from Audra, and I'm sorry, I can't pronounce her surname, Libinas. What has City of Holdfast Bay done with staff uniforms in regard to procurement and the life, end of life? So
yeah,
any action in that space?
So I am actually wearing a secondhand uniform here. So but when when someone leaves the City of Holdfast Bay, our PA to CEO holds them in a wardrobe upstairs. Anyone can go up there and grab what they need. But there is a real issue with uniforms because they have the logo on them. So we can't pass them on to salvos or beanies. So what we can do is we can cut the logo off and send it on to the RSPCA, who use animal bedding. But now with new technology like Rawtec and what the University of New South Wales are, there's real opportunities that we can do the right thing with workwear.
Yeah, and so talking about workwear, we had another question earlier sent to me from Nikki from SA Power Networks. So Nikki, they have a lot of PPE, so high-vis leftover stuff at the end of life. And she asked, what can be done in this area given that high-vis clothing and PPE is in most cases won't meet specific standards and requirements, and as a result there'll be no demand for it?
Yeah. So PPE is traditionally made out of that polycotton blend, so they're perfect for the Rawtec model. And when you're looking at a big organisation like SA Power Networks, they'd have a lot of tonnages that they could pass on to Rawtec and include in their procurement process.
Yeah, okay. So that might, if we had set up in Adelaide at some point, then that could go to that. Okay, interesting. And another question here from Mender Australia relating to textiles dumped at donation bins. I'm sad to say I've seen this firsthand a lot more recently since COVID has struck.
Mm.
Donation bins, and you can see these piles of clothing out
there. Yeah.
Mender Australia asks, what's the solution?
I think my understanding after speaking to the salvos since COVID is a lot of the salvo shops are closed at the moment, and we're all at home, we're going through our wardrobes and we want to have a bit of an autumn or a spring clean, but it's not the right time now to drop off your donations because, like everyone else, they're self-isolating to stop the COVID outbreak. So I think it's about having a more of a message in the community, do the right thing. Yes, please donate your clothes, but one, please donate appropriate clothes that can be resold, and please donate them in a manner which they will be able to use.
Mm, and that getting those messages out, I guess, is the solution. I know that I've heard that charities have cameras and so forth, big signs and stuff, but it still remains.
Yeah, and we have issues with illegal dumping at a salvos here in the City of Holdfast Bay, so we occasionally put up security cameras and put signs up. So yeah, I think sometimes signs aren't enough. It's about enforcement, so catching people doing the wrong thing, and once you catch a few people and tell them off, the message spreads and everyone starts to do the right thing.
Can you currently do that within council?
So general inspectors can find people illegal dumping. We need to catch them on spot in the act, but it can be done. Yeah.
Okay, I've got another question here from Helen Hayward. Are you considering working with other councils to implement changes to industry and to introduce a mandated stewardship again?
Yeah, so now I'm just sitting back and going through all my research. from here we're looking at what we can do as a local government. There is always a lot of power when local governments get together, especially when we're talking about procurements. We have those 9 councils that sign the MOU. So I think in terms of product stewardship, that probably sits at the national level, but there is real power when local governments get together and we can advocate for this to be implemented.
Yeah, no, that's an important role local government can certainly play, as well as the items you touched on earlier when it comes to procurement and so what I'm hearing is there's a lot of opportunity and a lot of already good things happening in this space, and it's just a matter of investing more, supporting more, potentially some legislation, etc., to really position Australia as a leader in circular textile management.
Absolutely, yeah.
So just want to finish up with a last question, Shani. So we've heard a lot today. You've covered a lot of scope and a lot of ground. What three takeaways would you like to leave the audience with after today?
Okay. I think what we need to see is a holistic approach. So it's not going to happen with one retailer introducing a program. So it needs to be a partnerships of programs between governments, NGOs, the whole supply chain, innovators and clothing collectors to increase our resource recovery rates. So one, it needs to be holistic. We need to get everyone involved on the same page, because so many people are involved in the garment industry. Like I said, one out of every six person is what is in the workforce is working in garment production. So holistic approach, engagement. So we need to think right up that waste hierarchy, and we need to get people thinking about there is value in their clothes. When they want to buy clothes, please think about buying secondhand, and please think about buying durable clothes. And don't chuck them in the bin if they've got a hole in it. Just get a needle and a thread out and try to fix it. And the last one I'll definitely say is that amazing opportunity we have here in the circular economy to invest in new technology where we can recycle these textiles, recover the resources and turn them into new products.
That was fantastic. Thank you so much, Shani, for your insight. Absolutely amazing. And I understand that you mentioned this before, and obviously we know very well that this was part of that Green Industries SA Win and Waste Leadership Scholarship that you won that made this all possible.
Yes. Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit just about that opportunity? And I've heard that they're about to launch another one.
Sure. Well, we've actually got two women in circular economy / women in waste here. So Kat was actually the 2017-18 winner, and I was the 18-19 winner. So it's Green Industries acknowledging a leader in the South Australian circular economy. So they're about to open nominations for new applications. I would, if you're a woman in the circular economy here in South Australia, please, please consider putting a nomination in, because for me, it was an amazing opportunity. I've never gone to Europe. It really expanded my networks and it led to a lot of personal professional growth for me, as well as allow me to research an issue I'm really passionate about, which is textile waste.
I agree with you, Shani, from my own experience in the food waste journey. It is a great initiative, Green Industries SA, so go GISA. I'm really pleased to hear that they will be launching another round soon.
Yeah. So I'd say within the next few weeks, so keep an eye on the Green Industries website. And the application form, Laura, will be on the Green Industries website.
You see that question there?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much, Shani, and thank you so much to our audience for listening to your questions.
Yeah.
This webinar has been recorded, so we will be sharing a copy of the webinar afterwards. I encourage you to keep in touch. We'll have some and watch out for our future webinars we've planned with future industry leaders. So thank you.
Can I just quickly thank a lot of people that were involved in this research project? Are you able to get that slide up? There's so many people. I am the more I know, the less I feel I know in this field, and it's the experts on this screen that made this research project possible. So thank you so much. Your name's on the screen. And I really need to thank the unofficial best council in South Australia, the City of Holdfast Bay. You supported me in pushing me to nominate this ward. You were so flexible, providing me with a lot of resources in getting this project done. And to Alex, my manager, I know I am a terrible speller and my grammar is atrocious. And you never complained once about reading my blogs, www.circular.clothing, looking at my research project. So thank you so much. Thank you to all the experts on the screen. And thank you so much to my mum and dad. They are officially the best parents in the world. it's been a big year for me, and without your unconditional love and support, I wouldn't have been able to do this, and looking after my kids when I went away. You're amazing, and I can't wait to hug you outside of COVID. So thank you so much to everyone.
That's lovely. Thank you, Shani. And take care, everyone. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.